Professor Dave again, I want to tell you about cholera.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
You've probably heard of cholera, at least in passing, but what is it and what causes it? Cholera is an acute, which means severe and sudden in onset, diarrheal disease that's contracted by either drinking water or eating food contaminated with the cholera bacterium. It can be absolutely deadly if left untreated, killing within hours in some cases. The infection can range from mild to severe, with approximately 1 in 10 cases characterized by profuse vomiting, watery diarrhea, and leg cramps. The rapid fluid loss can cause extreme dehydration and shock, which is what makes the disease so life-threatening. Let's get a closer look at this killer. While cholera is generally rare in the United States and other industrialized nations, global cases of cholera have been steadily rising. CDC estimates that each year there are 2.9 million cases of cholera around the world, with 95,000 people dying from the disease. Cholera isn't spread from person to person, but rather through inadequate sewage management. Epidemics are usually traced back to contamination of a water or food source with the feces of an infected person. And while we're talking about epidemics, let's make sure we know what that means. The term endemic means the baseline amount of a particular disease that's usually present in a community. The term epidemic simply means there are more cases than expected. A pandemic is the worldwide spread of a new disease. In fact, 7 pandemics of cholera have been recorded since 1817. While it can be life-threatening, cholera can be easily prevented and treated if you have the right resources and knowledge. Now that we have some global context, let's talk about the bacterium that causes this disease and how it's able to do so much damage. Cholera is caused by a bacterium called Vibrio cholerae, and more specifically by the toxin-producing serotypes V. cholerae O1 and O139. The genus Vibrio is part of a major group of gram-negative, facultatively anaerobic, fermentative rods. Let's break down what that means. These bacteria are rod-shaped. They're gram-negative, which means they have a thin peptidoglycan layer. Facultatively anaerobic means that they can live and grow either with or without molecular oxygen, so they can make things work even if oxygen isn't present. In contrast, an obligate anaerobe can only grow in the complete absence of molecular oxygen. Finally, when there isn't any oxygen present, these bacteria undergo the process of fermentation, which is a non-oxygen requiring metabolic process for breaking down glucose. Vibrio species can grow in a variety of temperatures and tolerate a wide pH range of around 6.5 to 9. V. cholerae, in particular, can grow in the absence of salt, which sets it apart from the other Vibrio species, along with its ability to produce cholera toxin. Looking at the structure of these bacteria, Vibrios often have a single polar flagellum, which is an antenna-like structure that helps them move around. Different strains have various pili, which are hair-like structures on the surface, to help mediate virulence, or give them their ability to cause disease. The cell wall structure is also quite important. All Vibrio strains have lipopolysaccharides, which consist of 1, lipid A, or endotoxin, 2, core polysaccharide, and 3, an O polysaccharide side chain. It is the case that the lipopolysaccharide, or LPS, generated by gram-negative bacteria can produce a much more powerful inflammatory reaction than gram-positive bacteria. The O polysaccharide of these bacteria is used to subdivide Vibrio into what's called serogroups. For instance, there are over 140 serogroups of V. cholerae, numbered O1 to O140. Aside from serotypes O1 and O139, other strains of V. cholerae generally don't produce cholera toxin and therefore don't cause disease. Believe it or not, classification can get even more specific. V. cholerae serotype O1 is further subdivided into serotypes and biotypes. Three serotypes in particular are recognized, including Inaba, Ogawa, and Hikojima. Depending on the properties that the bacteria are expressing, they can transition between serotype Inaba and serotype Ogawa, with serotype Hikojima being the transitional state where both Inaba and Ogawa properties are expressed. The two biotypes are classical and LTOR, which can be subdivided by morphologic and phenotypic properties. As we mentioned, 7 worldwide pandemics of V. cholerae infections have been documented since 1817. The classic biotype was responsible for the 6th worldwide pandemic, while the LTOR biotype is responsible for the 7th pandemic, which is still ongoing today. V. cholerae O1 does not produce a capsule, which is a protective polysaccharide layer on the outside of the cell, so infections with this organism typically can't spread past the confines of the intestine. The genes for V. cholerae are encoded on 2 circular chromosomes. However, plasmids, which are smaller circular DNA molecules that bacteria can trade with each other, including those that encode antimicrobial resistance, are commonly found in Vibrio species as well. Now let's talk about damage. The cholera toxin is responsible for those telltale symptoms of the disease. However, the genes that encode the cholera toxin are very intricately regulated, such that a complex cascade of events must be carried out just right to produce the toxin within the bacterium. That process gets incredibly complex, so we won't get into those details here. Once produced and properly assembled, the cholera toxin is a complex AB toxin. Many pathogenic bacteria produce AB toxins, which are made of 2 components, subunit A and subunit B. Subunit A is typically responsible for the enzymatic activity of the toxin, which is the part that does the damage. Subunit B is responsible for binding to specific receptors in a host cell and then transferring the enzyme across the membrane. With these types of toxins, isolated A subunits are enzymatically active but lack the ability to bind and enter cells. And isolated B subunits can bind to target cells, but they're non-toxic. Plus, the enzymatic component is not active until it is released. So it's a kind of teamwork. If you drink water contaminated with V. cholerae, the bacteria enters your digestive tract, and subunit B of the toxin binds directly to receptors in your intestinal tract. Subunit A of the toxin starts a chemical reaction that triggers a hypersecretion of water and electrolytes. In fact, an infected patient can lose as much as 1 liter of fluid per hour due to this chemical reaction. In addition to dehydration, such extreme fluid loss can lead to loss of bicarbonate or potassium, causing irregular heartbeat or kidney failure. If left untreated, the mortality rate is 60%. If treated promptly with electrolytes and fluid replacement, the mortality rate is less than 1%. Antibiotic therapy can help reduce toxin production in some cases. To confirm that someone has been infected with V. cholerae serogroup O1 or O139, the gold standard is to culture a stool specimen in a lab. In areas with limited lab testing, there's a rapid preliminary test called the Crystal VC dipstick that can help inform CDC if there might be an outbreak. There are also several vaccines available for those traveling to areas with known cholera activity. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.